Alrighty, so we've got Trina from Nevada. Hello, Trina. So good to see you again. I'm so glad you're with us. Today, we are going to talk about what iridologists can and can't say and what iridology can and can't do. Now, this is the kind of a topic that is very controversial amongst iridologists. There are those of us who are holding on to old beliefs. And there are those of us who have moved forward. And so we are going to be looking at what iridologists, we're going to actually look at both what old beliefs say and what the new beliefs are saying. There are lots of misconceptions about iridology. And again, these are perpetrated usually by people who are using the old styles of iridology. Iridologists who are up to date tend to be going with some of what I'm going to be teaching you today. So, if you've got comments, please do share them in the chat box, regardless of which platform you're with me on. And regardless of where you're joining me from, I would love to know where you are from. It's just so good to get to know my viewers and my students. All righty, so let's dive right in. All right. And for those of you who are with me on Instagram, I'm going to move my camera closer so you get a better view because I know when the camera's too far away, you don't get to see things very well. This iris shows what we would call a very resilient fiber structure. We've got tightly packed fibers throughout the entire body of the iris. Now, there are some slight indications of inherent predispositions, things that we would be watching for. And particularly, we're seeing that there might be some predispositions to some digestive concerns, maybe to some circulatory concerns and some skin concerns. But overall, the structure here is really, really nice. We would call this a high threads per square inch count. And that is a large part of what determines the resiliency or how a body will ward off disease and resist disease and how well it will recover from a disease or an injury. Now, it's really important that we remember that what we see in the iris is genetic. It's inherent. This person has done nothing to put any of that fiber structure there. That's what their parents, their grandparents, and their great grandparents have passed on and have blessed them with. So this eye does show strong resiliency. But looking at the eye doesn't, looking at the iris in particular, doesn't tell us what this person has done with that. It doesn't tell us exactly what's going on in their body. It shows us, again, where the inherent strengths and weaknesses are. And sometimes we work with clients who have symptoms, and their symptoms don't really match their eyes. Kind of like this old Rolls-Royce. Rolls-Royces are, now I've never owned one, but I've heard they are amazing, amazingly well engineered, that they don't break down. And if you do your basic maintenance with them, then they last forever. Now on Facebook, Ken is saying, so the fibers are not impacted by environmental or lifestyle factors. Ken, that is absolutely correct. Absolutely correct. We do another webinar where we show eyes of people before and after surgery, eyes of people before and after bone breaks, and the fiber structure does not change based on environment or lifestyle. And that is the idea that the fibers change based on environment and lifestyle. That's old school thinking that has been disproved. So thank you for asking that question, Ken. I love having the opportunity to explain that one. When we're looking at cars, you know, we've got this beautiful old Rolls-Royce, and even a Rolls-Royce, if it is not properly cared for, will eventually break down. Now, by the same token, you might have a car that is not as expensive, not as well engineered, one that might be, you know, thought to last for 15 years, but if you do all the right things, you do the lob job, the lube jobs and oil changes, you replace parts as they break down, you do all the right things, that car that was only supposed to last 15 years. It might last 20 or 25 years. So we need to think of this in terms of people now. A client may have been blessed with a really strong genetic potential, but if they don't do their lube jobs and oil changes, they can break down that strength. Their integrity, the integrity of their body, of how it responds, can break down, and they start to become ill. Truly, this is the kind of person who will come in to see me at the age of about 45, and they'll say, I don't understand it. I've never been sick a day in my life. Why do I now have arthritis, high blood pressure, and high cholesterol? Huh, well, you weren't supposed to have that. Your body is supposed to be strong and resilient. Your body genetically, if you've got these eyes, is strong and resilient. And if you had cared for it well, you wouldn't have those symptoms now. We still have this inherent predisposition. The fiber structure has not broken down because it's not going to break down. And when we know that this is the inherent predisposition of this person, and we do the right kinds of things, we can help this person regain their health. Someone who has an eye structure like this, on the other hand, is born with less resilience. We've got open gaps in the eyes. We call these lacunae. We've got shading. We've got hyper areas where things are pretty bright, right? We've got areas that are darker. And again, this person didn't do anything to put any of this there. This is what this person was blessed with genetically. Now, what I find is that people who have this type of an iris structure typically figure out pretty early in life that there's rules they need to live by. Like, this is the person who pays dearly if they party hard. This is a person who pays dearly if they don't get enough sleep. This is a person who pays dearly if they don't do their maintenance work. And so sometimes these people will come in quite broken down. They don't have quite as much good stuff to work with, but that doesn't mean everything is hopeless. It means that we can improve the functioning of their body within their genetic abilities. We can take them from the low end where they are probably manifesting, and that's probably why they came in to see us, up to the high end of their inherent potential, right? We're never going to add fibers in here, close these lacuna, make these shadings lighter. That does not happen. And so these people, like I said, often figure it out very early that they need to eat well. They figure out what foods work for them, what foods don't work for them. They figure out how much rest they need. They figure out what kind of exercise and activity they need. They even often figure out what kinds of supplements work well for them. Right now, so when they come in to see me, they're looking for that edge. They're usually looking to improve just a little bit because they think they can, and they usually can. Now, again, these people have less resilience. That doesn't mean we won't see improvement. Remember, the eye rides show genetic predispositions. They don't give us guarantees. So this person actually has followed all their own rules. They figured that out. They're doing really well with following their own rules. They might not have any obvious health issues. Because they figure the rules out early, they might actually feel really well into their 60s or 70s. And then age can catch up with them, and just the environment we live in can catch up with them. And so these people often just need a little chopping up, a little maintenance. Right. And if we work with them early enough in the process, like when they're in their 20s or 30s, we can often help them to have really, really amazing health. Now, again, I'm going to encourage you, if you've got questions about anything that I'm sharing with you today, please do ask. You know, when a client comes in with symptoms that don't match their eye rides, it's because they've either earned those symptoms through physical or emotional events. While iridology is a blueprint of the body's inherent patterns, it does not account for the abuse that is dished out. And so it might not even be as obvious as as what this girl is doing, smoking. We all know that smoking is detrimental on many levels, but it might be something simpler, like this person skips on sleep, or they've got a sedentary lifestyle, or they skip meals, or it could be just all kinds of things. They don't manage their stress well. These are all the kinds of things that can lead to breakdown in the body. Iridology informs us as to the best ways to care for the body, food choices, lifestyle, and supplements. When we understand the inherent tendencies and patterns, and that's what we need to do. We need to examine the irides for the inherent tendencies and patterns, compare that to our client's symptoms and their lifestyle and their diet, and work from there. In order to truly help people, iridologists need to have modalities. This is important. So we need to have understand and be able to use herbs or nutrition or homeopathy or aromatherapy or something, so that when we see these inherent patterns in a person's eyes, we can give them some concrete recommendations as to what they can do to improve their health outcome. We're not giving them recommendations to change their eyes, because it's not going to change their eyes. We're giving them recommendations to change their health outcome. Trying to do iridology without having supporting modalities is like taking your car to the repair shop and the mechanic says, yeah, indeed, your car's got a problem with the exhaust system, but I don't know what to do about it. You have to take it to Joe down the street. He knows how to fix them. I only know how to assess the problem. He knows how to fix them. I can't think of anybody who wants that kind of care for their body, right? They want to be speaking with someone who understands how to find the problem and what to do about it. So now that you know where we're headed with this, and we're going to do some case studies in just a moment, I'd like to introduce myself. My name is Judith Cobb. I am a master herbalist and a member of the Alberta Herbalist Association, a natural nutrient clinic, natural nutrition clinical practitioner. And I'm associated with both the Canadian Association of Holistic Nutrition Professionals and the Canadian Association of Natural Nutritional Professionals. And I am also a certified level 3 iridologist and a certified level 3 iridology instructor. Now, I am only one of 5 level 3 instructors in the world with the International Iridology Practitioners Association. This is a new level. Level 3 was just added a year ago, and I was one of the few instructors who took the course who actually went on to the certification process. I love teaching health professionals the art and science of iridology. And as importantly, I love teaching them how to integrate iridology into their existing clinical work so that we can reduce their consultation time, speed up their program creation time, and improve client compliance, all without sacrificing client care. Ken, who was with us on Facebook, says that makes so much sense. You got to have understanding of full body systems and how to leverage the information from iridology. Love your approach. Ken, thank you for that. I truly appreciate that feedback. Let's look at some eyes now. You want to look at some eyes? If you want to do some case studies, give me a thumbs up or let me know that you want to look at some case studies. I'm going to give that a moment to come in, because if you don't want to do case studies, we'll just end it right now. Okay, Trina's given me a thumbs up. I knew Trina would do that. I know I can count on Trina. Thanks, Trina. Appreciate that. Okay, so these are the eyes of my husband. The image on the left was taken when he was 42 years of age. The image on the right was taken when he turned 65. Now, many of you, oh, and yes, we're getting some good reaction. Whoops, sorry, Instagram people. I didn't mean to do that to you. Getting some good yeses and thumbs up from our Instagram audience. So this is brilliant. Thank you so much. Okay. So what we want to do is look at these. Now, depending on what your screen is showing you, many of you would likely say it looks like the image on the right that he's done some cleansing, that his eyes are bluer, And I'm going to definitely, and Ken wants case studies. Great, Ken, thank you. I'm going to blow that completely out of the water for you. All right. The first thing I want to point out is with before and after pictures, you have to verify that the same technology was used, not similar technology, but the same. In any scientific study, you must control the variables. You must control all the variables except the one you are measuring, correct? Does that make sense? If we want to know if something's working, we've got to control everything except the one thing we are measuring. And so the image on the left was taken with a print film camera that had an incandescent flash. I believe this was an Olympus camera. It was stolen, so I don't remember. I think it was an Olympus, I believe. The image on the right was taken with a Canon 24 megapixel that has an LED flash. Incandescent always shoots a little more yellow. LED shoots a little more blue. Different brands of cameras, different models of cameras. If you're shooting print pictures, print images, the brand of film and the brand of paper it was developed on, and even the settings on the printer or the developer will change the color output. So we cannot say before and after different colors cleansing happened. Not true, not true at all. Some people will say that, oh my goodness, this lacuna is much smaller. Look at these lacuna, look at how much smaller they are as well. Even these down here, look at them, they're smaller. Not true. What I want you to pay attention to is the size of the pupil. When we look at the fiber structure, these fibers are a certain length. And the garbage truck is just going down the alley. We'll just give it a moment to get out of the way so we don't have interference. It'll just be another second. He's just doing the people across the alley, I think. Okay. And so what we need to pay attention is if these fibers are a specific length. When the pupil is large, these fibers get pushed like this. They get compressed into a smaller area, but they don't telescope, they crinkle. Okay. And so as we squish this, think of this as being like a balloon. We can have a long, thin balloon, but if we compress it end to end, it's going to get fatter, right? And that's what we've got here. The large pupil compresses the fibers, makes things go fatter. When those fibers are stretched out, those same tissues get stretched out and the balloon gets elongated. So we cannot say that we've had that happen either. So we cannot claim healing from the eyes. Now, some people will want to look at these eyes and claim diseases, right? They may want to claim disease processes. They might look at this and say, you've got pigment here that you didn't have years ago. You are toxic. Have you seen anyone on Facebook doing an iris assessment talking about your bowel is toxic, your blood is dirty, your kidneys need cleansing? Have you seen anything like that? If you have, give me a yes. If you've seen anything like that, they are proclaiming the condition of the body from looking at the eyes. Have you seen anything like that? Yeah. Okay. Yeah, absolutely. We cannot proclaim that. What happens on a daily basis, the foods you eat, things like that, the environment you're in doesn't change your eyes. Your eyes tell us where your weak links are. And when we understand that, we understand why this person has accumulated this pigment here, why this has built because of genetic cues over time. And this then tells us which organ wants to be stressed and which organs it wants to share its stress with. That's all it tells us. It does not tell us this person has done awful things to their body. As I said, these are my husband's eyes. He doesn't drink. He doesn't smoke. He doesn't drink coffee. He doesn't drink pop. He, our diet is pretty much whole foods, very little sugar at all. And most of what we have for sweetening is maple syrup or raw honey, right? So it's like, where'd this come from? This is a genetic cue. So what we can do when we see eye photos is we can ask questions as we understand the markings and as we understand our client's symptoms, then we know what markings to look for in an eye. So for example, we might see something in his eyes that suggests that there might be a predisposition towards him internalizing his stress and burning through B vitamins, vitamin C, calcium, and magnesium very quickly. And it shows up in both sets, in both images. So the question would be, if he's coming in talking about stress headaches or gut issues, we would ask him about stress, because we know stress impacts can impact headaches. We know it can impact gut. When we look at the nutritive zone and we understand all the different levels of markings we see here, we can ask him more things like, tell me how you handle proteins. Do you tend to be farty or burpy? If you're farty, tell me about the gas. Is it really stinky? Is there a bit of an odor? Is it just air? And as we, again, ask the questions linking his symptoms to what we see in his eyes, we get a clearer picture of how his body is functioning now based on his genetics. So I do not tell him, you don't digest proteins well. I'm not a doctor. I can't make that diagnosis, nor do his eyes tell me that for sure, because maybe even though his eyes say there is a predisposition to that, maybe he's been using a lot of aromatic herbs that will help him to digest his food better, that will stimulate digestive juices, in which case there may be no digestive symptoms, or he's doing the right things already. He doesn't need me nagging at him. He needs me congratulating him for doing such an amazing job. If I see any markings in his eyes that suggest blood sugar imbalances, then I might ask the question, what is your energy like? Is it stable through the day? Do you crave carbohydrates? Have you had your hemoglobin A1C checked recently? Right. And depending on the answers to those questions, then I know how to coach him with his diet and his lifestyle. Is this making sense, that the eyes don't tell us the problem? They actually teach us the questions to ask to correlate his symptoms to what his genetic predispositions are. Do you see what we're doing here? We're never diagnosing. We're never prescribing. We ask questions. We use the eyes to ask questions, but we're always looking for markings that correlate in some way to the client's symptoms. And this is where that understanding of anatomy and physiology is so important. It's one of the reasons why I absolutely insist that my students have anatomy and physiology under their belt, not a general knowledge of, but an actual college level course. Ken says, love your approach. I think all labs need to be approached in much the same manner. I absolutely agree. Have my clients go back to their doctor. I will often send them with a list of labs that I would like to have done. Sometimes the doctors get a little bit snooty about it, and sometimes they're fine with it. It just depends on the doctor, right? And it depends on how my client presents it to the doctor. When we get those labs back and we correlate the labs to the symptoms, and then we use the eyes to dig deeper to understand why these labs and these symptoms are the way they are, we can then go back to our nutrition, go back to our supplements, go back to our lifestyle to create the program. And I only ever create a program one step at a time. I never do a massive overhaul, because that's the fastest way to guarantee client failure. right? We do one or two small steps now, and in a month we meet again and we build on it based on successes. If they didn't have success with it, if they were unable to implement, we pivot and go a different direction. When iridologists diagnose from the eye, when they say, you have this problem, they do a tremendous disservice, and it's potentially dangerous for the client and the iridologist. And I think it's really dangerous to do an iris assessment on social media from photos where you don't know what the text settings were for that image. I mean, every computer screen displays images differently as well. I have four computer screens. I can put the same image up on each of those four screens and they look entirely different. The colors are very different based on the screen. And so I think it's really dangerous to just do an analysis based on an image on a computer screen with no opportunity to have a conversation with the client. As a practitioner, as well, the information that is provided by iridologists who do those online assessments where they give all of this detailed information is massively overwhelming to the recipient. And 9 times out of 10, the recipient is going to take things out of context. They'll pick and choose the things they want to work with, and they'll throw away the things that are too hard or that they don't feel for themselves are important. In my 40 years, I've been at this for over 4 decades, folks. I have never seen a client who could absorb and act properly on a complete iris analysis with a complete dietary and supplement overhaul in one fell swoop. But I used to do it that way in my early days as a practitioner. And I used to actually, because I was trained in another school of thought, I wasn't constitutional when I started. And I used to diagnose and prescribe all the time. I'm so glad I didn't end up in jail. Whew, could have been a problem, but it meant my clients weren't getting the results that we wanted them to get. It meant they couldn't stick with the program. So again, this client, camera's taken with a different camera, different lighting, so the images will appear different. We see that we've got the pigment accumulation over time, and we've got the pigment that is hugging the collarette. None of this gives us enough information to make a diagnosis. Everything we see in these eye photos gives us information with which to ask questions. This is a female client of mine. She's been with me for many years. She is now in her mid-50s. These were taken when she was, she's in her early 50s, sorry. These were taken when she was about 44. When she came in to see me, and again, we'd been working several years at this point in time. My clients come in for a few appointments, then they go off and they do their homework and they're feeling great. And I see, then they come back 4 or 5 years later when things are starting to come unglued again. And this was her coming back when things were starting to come apart. She is 5 feet, 10 inches tall. She weighed 200 pounds and she was gaining weight, which she was not happy about. And so with that, she was also noticing that her joints were aching. She was having winter depression. I live north of the 49th parallel. And that means that we have seasonal affective disorder, and she was starting to fall into that. She was taking a drug from her doctor, Zoloft, and she had really painful menstrual periods. Her inherent predisposition is that of connective tissue. She has what we consider to be the connective tissue subtype. She also has a central heterochromia that suggests that her liver might want to be messing with things genetically, that her liver genetically doesn't want to do its job well. That's a better way of saying it. And that her liver may also be wanting to mess with digestion. And if you're familiar with traditional Chinese medicine, you know that the liver has a lot to do with emotion and depression as well. So as we look at this, we also want to remember that liver has an awful lot to do with how we balance our hormones. We also see that hanging on to the edge of that brown, we have this yellowish color, which tells us that her kidneys may not want to do their job properly. Oh, look, we have this lacuna. It's called a shoe lacuna because it looks like a footprint from a man's shoe. That also suggests an inherent predisposition towards kidney. Again, when we understand traditional Chinese medicine, kidneys control the joints. If the kidneys want to be unbalanced, it's more likely we are going to see an arthritic situation. Kidneys regulate uric acid. Uric acid can lead to inflammation. Inflammation always leads to weight gain and insulin resistance. So I asked her about her digestion. She said she has no problems digesting. But of course, her eyes are saying, yeah, I don't quite agree with that. Her diet was not right on. Her diet was actually, she had fallen off the bandwagon, so to speak. So her diet was not great. So I knew there were some digestive things that she wasn't paying attention to. Her bowel movements were like rabbit pellets. And she was drinking 3 to 4 cups of coffee per day, in spite of all of the training I had done with her over why she shouldn't. Regardless of what anyone says about coffee being good, it is hard on the thyroid, liver, stomach lining, adrenal glands, and it increases acid and inflammation. I do not believe coffee is good. So at this appointment, we suggested eliminating coffee because that is one way you can love your liver. We also suggested adding a collagen supplement. I work with the Nature Sunshine product line and they have a lovely collagen supplement. Also wanted her to be using a good digestive enzyme. Nature Sunshine has a beautiful one of those here in Canada. It's called Garden Essence. In the US, it is called Proactzyme. And I wanted her to be eating a lot of leafy greens every day. Okay, that was her, this first appointment, really, first appointment in this series for her. In her second, and did you see how simple that was? We took away the coffee. We've done that before. I knew she could do it. We got her eating leafy greens. So those are two things that are going to support the liver and the nervous system, actually, when you look at the nutrition profile of what they do. We got her using digestive enzymes, and we got her using collagen. That's all we did. How simple is that? How simple is that? So on her second appointment, she had done everything. I knew she could because she's done it before. Her joints were improving. So this is just a month later. She noticed her joints were less squeaky, as I would call it, and her periods were getting better. Her depression was also lifting, even though we were in the middle of winter. And even though she was on antidepressants, the meds were not working, and she didn't want to increase them or change them. So now we could build to the next step. And for her, the next step was, how much water are you drinking in a day? Well, maybe 3 glasses. How about sleep? How's your sleep? We know that liver is the seat of most insomnia, according to traditional Chinese medicine. And she said her sleep was very broken and that she often had a little bit of insomnia in there as well. So now I was able to suggest that she make sure she gets protein 3 times a day and a couple of protein snacks. So we talked about what is protein, again, because we've talked about this before with her, how big is a serving of protein? And so we got her to do that. I suggested she should talk to her doctor about getting a prescription for a seasonal affective disorder lamp to do some light therapy. And because that is very, very helpful for the winter blues. I suggested that she needed to be getting a 30-minute walk every day. And I didn't care if she got her heart rate up. I just wanted her moving and I wanted her outside. And I wanted her to be increasing her water to 6 glasses a day. So we've added protein 3 to 5 times a day, asked her to look at getting a sad lamp, got her to go for walks, and got her to increase her water consumption. Again, very simple things, very measurable things. She could go check. I've had my water, check. I did my 30 minutes, check. I got my sad lamp. So in the third appointment, when she came back a month later, the doctor had given her a prescription for a sad lamp. And the only reason she needed a prescription was she had extended benefits, which meant that she could claim it against her health insurance, right? And so she got the sad lamp and she loves it. She's using it per recommendation, and she finds that alone, the sad lamp boosts her energy, lifts her moods, and just makes her feel great. She's increased her water. She's getting better at the protein. She's not 100% on it, but she's getting there. She certainly is doing more and better protein. And she's getting the walks in at least every other day, which is a huge improvement from 0 to 3 or 4 times a week. I was a happy camper. This is all based on her eyes. Did you see how we looked and understood the different markings that we see, correlated them back to what they could mean with her symptoms, and then were able to create recommendations from there? Did that make sense? Do you see how this worked? And I didn't make a diagnosis, and I didn't prescribe anything. I asked questions and I gathered information connecting symptoms to eyes and lifestyle. And then I was able to make recommendations. If that made sense to you, give me a heart or some love somewhere. All right, so here we have a case study again, and there's Trina giving me a heart. Thanks, Trina, truly appreciate that. All right, this is a young man, 24 years of age. And as we look at his irises, his irides, what we see is he's got good structure. He's got good fiber density. It's harder to see fiber structure through brown pigment in a true brown eye. However, when we don't see any markings in the body of the iris, per se, no lacunae, then we can assume that there is a fairly decent fiber structure underneath it. He has the potential for good resiliency, for excellent health, if he would only take care of himself. Notice he has a lot of contraction furrows. These contraction furrows suggest that he could be predisposed to anxiety and stress and depression if he's not well nourished. So let's, as we look at his eyes, can you see that there's also some cloudiness here? This little bit of a white haze hanging on the very edge of his iris is telling us that his liver is not balancing. This is a very dynamic sign. This is in the cornea. His liver is not balancing his carbohydrates well. It's not processing them well. So the question is, what's his lipid profile? And that's not just cholesterol and triglycerides. It's also blood sugar balance. What we need to remember is type 2 diabetes and elevated cholesterol are the Bobbsey twins. They go hand in hand. Notice that his eyes are also very bloodshot, which suggests a lot of inflammation throughout his body. So I would ask him about inflammation. I can't tell him he has inflammation, but I can ask him. So I would ask him if he had any inflammation in his body, and he might not even know what that means. So I would ask him if he has any chronic aches and pains. And he does. He does. We're going to talk about that in a moment. I would want to ask him about his stress and his anxiety levels. I would ask him about his liver. Now, again, he may not know what his liver does. I may need to give him ideas of what his liver does. Do you have these various symptoms? I might need to ask about his circulation because of things that I see here. So here's his history. At the age of 24, he is overweight by at least 40 pounds. He has a history of depression, anxiety, and gout, and he's on medications for depression and anxiety and gout. He had a very poor family life growing up with a lot of emotional abuse. I know this young man quite well, and I know his parents quite well, and I've seen his parents interact with him and with his other adult siblings, and truly, even now, his parents are clearly, they clearly have favorites, and this person is not one of them. He has many aunts and uncles who have passed away in their 60s due to cardiovascular issues. So what we've seen with him in his behaviors and in his lifestyle is when he's good, he's very, very good. He will cut out the pop. He'll eat more vegetables. He will get out to the gym every day. When he does all of that, it calms the gout down, it calms his emotions down, and he's actually quite functional. However, when he's upset, he hits the sugar, he stops working out, the depression tanks, the anxiety skyrockets, and the gout returns, and he ends up almost unable to walk. Ideally, with someone like this, because we know he's prone to the anxiety and the stress, so we know what nutrients we need to be building in him, we know what junk food we need to take away, right? We know his liver wants to cause problems. And again, the liver is the seat of depression. It plays roles with the pancreas to balance the blood sugars. It processes the carbohydrates to keep your cholesterol and your triglycerides and your blood sugars in balance. So ideally, with this young man, I would probably want him, now in all just fairness here, he's my son-in-law, which means that I cannot give him recommendations. He's going to have to come to me to ask me, right? I have many children-in-law, and what I know is mothers-in-law should not offer advice unless they are asked for it. So I'm good with that. If he were to ask me for advice, I would probably want him on ashwagandha or cordyceps. I would want him on methylated B vitamins and probably some milk thistle, right? I want to support the liver. I want to help him balance his folate and his B12. And for that, we're going to need them methylated because of his eye color. And we want to support his adrenal glands to help him handle his stress better. I would want him to work out 3 to 4 times per week for about 30 minutes. And I would want him to cut out the soda and drink more water and eat more leafy greens. So really, we would give him a few supplements. We would want him to cut out the soda and replace it with water, have a serving of leafy greens every day, and a workout 3 or 4 times a week. So fairly easy stuff. Having said that, if I've made recommendations to a client and they come back to see me and they've not been able to do it, I do not jump down their throats. I don't beat them up for it. I want to find out, what were they able to do? Were they able to do some of it? Could they get in 2 workouts a week? Well, that's great. You weren't doing any before. 2 per week is amazing. That's a 200% improvement, right? If they were able to cut out most of the soda, but not all of it, there's still maybe, instead of, he typically would drink 2 quarts a day or 2 liters a day. If he gets it down to 1 can a day, then I'm going to be really happy that he's done that. And I'm going to encourage him to continue working on it, right? Always, always give an accolade whenever you can. So we know that iridologists can't diagnose or prescribe. And I'm hoping that that's what you're taking away from this, is that they can't diagnose or prescribe. Too many iridologists are using old and disproven information. They are diagnosing, they are prescribing. They cannot legally do that. Even medical doctors who use iridology should not be doing that. The safest way to practice iridology and be of the best service to our clients is to use iridology to guide, as a guide in our assessment of our clients. We use the eyes to stimulate conversation, to help us ask the right kinds of questions and get the right kinds of information. Just want to drop this in quick 30 seconds here. The Dynamic Iridology Assessment System course is coming up again, starting on October 12th. It is the only live, online, fully mentored course for nutritionists, herbalists, naturopaths. Think of that as anyone who has an anatomy and physiology course under their belt, and they want to work with clients, or they are working with clients, and they want to be able to streamline their work with their clients without sacrificing client care. This is so important. If you want to learn more than just one marker means one thing, If you actually want to learn how the markers work together, how they correlate, then this course is for you. If you want one marker means one thing, go somewhere else and take a weekend course or read a book, right? And I'm not being harsh there, I'm being real. That's what you will get. In the Dynamic Iridology Assessment System course, this is 20 live 2.25-hour webinars that are recorded for playback on demand. And we include live group mentoring twice each month for all of the students who are in the course and even those who have graduated already. If they have done the course, even if they've certified, if they would like support on something, they are welcome to come back to the mentoring. We have a student and alumni, oops, it's not on Facebook anymore. It's now on MeWe group. Some of you are in my Facebook group, which is for the general public. My students and alumni have a private MeWe group. You also receive a 225-page digital textbook that you download, 45 pages of cheat sheets, which are your study notes. And I include in my course IPAS certification mentoring for any of my students who want to certify. This is a lot of one-on-one time. Most IPA instructors charge extra for the mentoring for certification. We do I provide you with the case studies you need that are a part of the certification process. So that way we both know what you're working with. We know the technology that was involved with it. Here's what one of my students, now did I actually hit everything there? I did. One of my students said this, I asked Chris, why did she take my course? Why did she take Dynamic Iridology? She is a herbalist and a wellness coach. She said, I wanted to improve my offerings as a health coach. I did not have a foundational framework for building individual programs based on each client's unique needs. Constitutional iridology was that missing link, and you consistently reinforce that foundation. Fantastic. That's what I was aiming to do. Now, Trisha Colstow, sent me this after her second lesson. Remember, there's 20 lessons, right? She sent it this to me after the second. I just wanted to say that as a new student in the Dynamic Iridology program who has worked in iridology previously and was certified by another teacher, I have learned more in the first two lessons of Dynamic Iridology than in all my previous iridology training. I'm so glad I decided to sign up. I know that after taking this course, I will be able to offer my clients the best and most up-to-date knowledge. Love that. Now, for those of you who may be interested, you've got that A and P under your belt already, and you're thinking, I wonder if this course would be good for me. Or I already know I want to learn iridology, but I want to learn more about this course to see if this course is the right one for me. And so if that is you, if you're thinking those things and you've got that A and P under your belt, I encourage you to book a Zoom video call with me. This is just a 15-minute call for us to look at your credentials, what you're wanting to do with iridology, for me to give you more information about the course. And you know, if it's a good fit, then if we've got time, we'll lengthen out the call and get you enrolled. If it's not a good fit, I will offer you other opportunities. I'll give you direction as to what I would suggest based on my four decades of experience, your next move should be. So if you're considering an iridology course and you're loving the idea of having a teacher, a live teacher, someone you can reach out to with questions, someone who will support you with in your journey, even after you complete the coursework, even if you've certified through the course, then hop on. Go to tinyurl.com/insight-call. Let's have a call and let's see if this is a good fit for you. Amazing. So with that, I'm not seeing any other questions or comments come in. So good to have you with me today. Thank you for prioritizing this time and for being with me. I hope this was useful for you and that you see that what iridologists can and can't do, what they can and can't say, and how iridology is best used in a practical clinical setting. I hope you have a fantastic day. We'll talk to you soon. Bye for now.